this light, tearing apart my old disguise. But I can't open my eyes. Still I see you. Oh, my lips color my body. Oh, I may smile at what you feel like forever. And I am temple, your temple.
Oh, behind me now, just get behind me.
Yeah.
still alive. How many of those people? Let me see your hands. You should be dead, but you're still alive. I love being with you tonight. You know that it's a gift to be here tonight, don't you? Those are my people. And sometimes, the bravest thing we can do sometimes is just keep breathing. Keep breathing. It's brave to live sometimes. And I'm so thankful for all of you guys tonight being here with me after so many times when I should be dead, but I'm still here. I choose to be alive, especially because the odds say I should die. I wrestle death. Wife Kristen Miller on the drums right here. This is my husband Josh Sturm on the guitar. My favorite guitarist, actually. Guitar playing. Actually, my favorite guitar playing. I have to say that because, of course, they know I like him, but he's like really my favorite guitar player of all. And I'm Lacey, and we're thankful to be here. So, so, so thankful. I don't even know. That's not a really good word for it. For so many reasons. And you know, me and Josh, we've been married 15 years this year. Just got an anniversary. Now, I don't know why you guys are cheering about that, but it is crazy to me, because I'm in it, you know? I'm like, what? Because I haven't seen a lot of things that look like Josh and how he loves me. I just haven't seen that very much. I didn't grow up on the same side of the tracks as Josh. He had a different experience growing up. And it was hard for me to trust in that kind of a goodness. because I just didn't see it very often. And there's a beautiful stories when people go through hell and they come out on the other side, but there's a crazy miracle about the people who never go through those things. What a crazy miracle that is, when all I've seen is people going through that, and here's somebody who like flips the script, and you're like, what? That's real? You guys are like loving each other. So it's hard to trust, but what's crazy is that even though my reality was only one way, I remember my friend Melanie, who's been with us, she's over here on the side. She's been with us from, this is Melanie over here. She's been my assistant since we started in Flyleaf as passerby in a 15-passenger 88 Ford Club Wagon van. And she got in there and said, I'm going to do your hair and makeup when you go on tour. And who knew where it was going to go, but she's still with me. You guys give it up for Melanie. She's really the reason why I'm still alive. Her prayers have saved my life more than once. And I remember Melanie saying to me one time when we were playing with POD for the first time, we were all starstruck, like, what is happening? What's our life? This is crazy. And Melanie was like, I remember the lyric when he says in one of his songs, life doesn't have to be like this. Life doesn't have to be like this. Life doesn't have to be like this. And that's something that it registered in her mind when she was going through something, and she's like, that's all she ever saw. And it was like God was saying, life doesn't have to be this way. There's another life. There's another way. Things can change. Things do change. There are overcoming stories. And that's what I was trying to figure out with Josh. It's like, really? I mean, I just went crazy right now. Are you staying? Like, it's not when everything's perfect that I feel his love for me. It's when everything is falling apart and he's staying. And that's when I'm like, why? You're for real. I'm sorry, I keep talking about you like you're not standing there. But really and truly, this song really means a lot to me. And I know there's some people in here that this song needs to be for you. And there's some people in here who have loved somebody who didn't know how to receive it. They didn't believe in it. And this is maybe your song for them. It, life can be different. It doesn't have to be the way you've always known. So I'll sing to you and I'll sing with you. It's called Roxanne. Put away your makeup. has gone from upside down to right side up again. Cause she believes until she sees. Five long months looking at trees that seem like they are dead. Black and twisted, broken still, full bloom inside her head. Cause she believes till she can see it. Turning pages, unlock these cages. Quiet days we can hear the sound. Every stone in the earth comes out. To creep out now. Never been so loud. Making way for the underway of the death in every side. To creep out now. Never been so loud. Right when the world is laughing at itself, all she can do is cry. But when the world is scared and crying out, she laughs fearless inside. Cause she believes till she can see. Floating freely, breathing easy over stratospheres. The show that leads those glory stars, redeeming all the years. Do you believe? And will you dream of turning the pages, open these cages? Quiet days we can hear this sound. And the stone in the earth comes down. Learn to creep out now. Never been so loud. Making way for the undulate of the death in every sound.
Find a place nearby for her to stay. Just someone to keep my hands clean. It's my meals and go away.
That's a cover song from Neil Young. We made it sort of more rocky than it was originally, but I saw you singing the words over here. I used to love that album when I was in junior high. I used to listen to that album all the time, and I didn't really get it until actually I left Flyleaf, and the song kept playing in my head for some reason. And you know, I wanted the guys to be able to move on and do whatever was best for their families and keep going, but I'm gonna tell you the truth, when they played that first show with another singer, it really broke my heart, and I didn't expect that to be so, I didn't expect that to happen the way that it did inside me, you know? I never really talked about this because, you know, it takes a long time to process things sometimes, and I'm gonna talk to you guys about that for just half a second, because sometimes we talk too early, before we've processed, before we've healed, and sometimes we feel like we're supposed to talk, but we're not healed yet, so it's okay not to talk. And sometimes the mark of healing is that you're able to talk and you don't have to, it doesn't hurt you anymore. So there's timing, okay? Because like in this culture where we just value being honest and sharing all our stories and doing all that, sometimes we hurt ourselves in the process because we haven't figured it out yet. And we just celebrate the mess without getting out of it. And so we celebrate, oh yeah, it's okay to have a mess because we're so worried that people are going to judge us for being in the mess. But it's good to come out and be healthy. There's nothing wrong with healing. It's actually good for us to heal. So that's why I didn't talk about this for a while. But it did hurt. It broke my heart whenever they did that for a show, because I thought Flyleaf meant something really honest to me. You know, it was me talking about stuff that I went through. I always had to mean it, you know. And then they had Kristen May, who I'm so thankful was able to come in and sing that from her own place. And all you guys sing it from your own place too. That's the cool thing about art and music, you know, you have your own place. But something in me was like, really? You just need a voice? You just need another female? You know, it's like it just felt something about it was hard, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so it's interesting because that's the culture we live in. We think our needs are here, external. They're just, if I could just have another meal, or if we could just meet these needs that are external, then we'd be satisfied. And then we get all our needs met. We're the most need-met country in the world that's ever been. And we're still so freaking needy in our souls. We're like the most needy in our souls than any other generation. Because we're all about what we just, if I could just get this outward thing. And that's what that last song was about, really, to me. It's like, we're in a generation where we think if we could just have a girlfriend who could make us happy, or a boyfriend, or we could have that job, or we could have the thing, you know, whatever the thing is, we need the thing, so that then when we get there, then we'll be okay. And it just makes us so lonely, because it's really beneath the surface that all that stuff, and we need to be whole, right? I'm sorry, I'm talking, I don't know what I'm talking about. But this next song is also about that. This next song, it's called Reconcile. It's kind of newer song. We're working on another album, but albums are weird now because they just come out. I remember hearing one of my favorite band's albums after they put out all the songs, and I was like, okay, well, that was not very exciting. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? I heard all those songs, okay, whatever. It's like watching a really bad preview where they give everything away or something. And you're like, okay, saw this movie. I didn't laugh. It was all funny in the preview. But we do have more songs that we put out. But this is one of the songs we put out that's going to be on the new album. Many of you probably might have heard it already, but it's Reconcile. And it's about that same message, you know. There's a lot of messages in it, but it's just about reconciling, making things, you know, we're going to come together as a family when we have a funeral or when we have a wedding for fighting, you know. This happened with Flyleaf, by the way. The last time we met was at a funeral It was our last show. It was at a funeral. Our sound guy was in a car accident. He passed away. And we all played a show, a benefit show for his wife and his son. And the next time we met was at Melanie's wedding. And we get together when we separate over those things, right? And God wants a family. He wants us to love each other. And in those moments, we have to figure it out. Or we have to feel like crap that we weren't there. Right? So, you know, in America, we get together, right? We get together as a family sometimes when things are hard. When there's tragedy. But we can also get together when we're celebrating and rejoicing. Like we just did when we sang that other song. We were like, hey, we're still here. Some people in here have cheated death. What's up? Hey, we're still here. Ha ha. I'm 41. No, 42. I was supposed to die at 16 and 26 and so many other times. I was supposed to die the day I was born and when I was a child. And shut up. I'm 42. What up? Yeah, what up? Feeling 42. I really love it, actually. And I just laugh because I didn't think I'd make it here, and here we are. Not just me, but all of you are with me today. That's just so crazy. You were like, shut up. Where's the song? I'm sorry. We're going to play it. Anyway, this song is about all that stuff randomly. I don't know if it stitched together and made any sense, but I didn't write it down. I'm not good at it. It's called Reconcile. I saw my knuckles were bleeding for the right reasons. Fighting the good fight in every open season. Now my hands are busy pulling up planks of wood. My shock is filling up with my own blood. Waiting for the clarity to come. But maybe I'm just bleeding to death. And maybe that's just the fate of my own blood. Solving the waiting by reckoning myself already dead. Reconciled at the wedding of funeral pyre, romancing pride to death, disgusting categorizing life. And how do we bleed and how do we breathe a love we're too proud to see? The pride that turns the holy into blasphemy. But I will let you breathe on me. And I can't you shut up and shut up and die. This next song is brand new. We only played it one time, live. So, it's called Not Your Fight.
Thank you.
That was Atticus. He likes to catch frogs. It's his favorite thing to do. And that's what he says at the end. How can I go catch frogs? In case you wondered at the, there was a lot of weird things people thought he was saying. So this is our last song. Thank you guys for doing that song for the first time right here. No prize. And Atticus's first performance. So, how many people here have ever heard this story from, I wrote a book called The Reason. Has anybody read that book? How many people have not heard the story that I wrote about in The Reason? This song is actually about when I was, I wrote a book about this time in my life. After it was way long time past, right? We talked about that earlier. After I healed from it and could look back and see and remember, I looked back over my life and I was trying to find the flyleaf moments. The moments when there was clarity. The moment when a story ended and a new story was beginning. The moment when things changed in my mind. I looked at those moments throughout my life, and originally the title was supposed to be A Passerby's Flyleaf Moments. But, you know, the publishers thought it was better or something else anyway. So, but that's what it is. That this song's about when I was 16 years old, and I hated myself, and I hated people, and I hated God. And if you talk to me about God, I hated you more than everybody. I thought it was like, actually I didn't believe in God. So I thought that was really, I didn't really actually know what I was saying. And because of this experience, I know for a fact that if I look at somebody and they say that they hate God or that they don't believe, it's just because they don't really know what they're saying. And I understand what that is, to think of God in a way that's wrong. We're creatures, he's creator. I mean, how can we conceive of creator when we're the creatures? It's like the Lego movie, I don't know. No, I don't know. I'm just saying, when I was in that place, everything was so horrible. Like, it just felt like everything was so dark. And like, what's the point of all this? What's the point of all this? We're just accidents that just happen. And we're just waiting to die. And then tragedy happens. And then we have to just live through it. And I just don't get it. Right? And this is like my mindset. And then everybody just is stupid. I hate everybody. If you're happy, then you're an idiot, because we live in a messed up world. And I had a cousin that was murdered by his stepfather, beaten to death by his stepfather, and I remember thinking, how can anybody be happy in a world like this? You're either really messed up or you're naive and you just don't know, right? That was my mentality. If you tell people about God, I realized that's when I stopped believing in God. At 10 years old, my cousin died. I remember thinking, that's telling people to sit in a broken chair. Just shut up about it. It's just us out here. You're on your own. Figure it out. And then I had to liberate all the people who had this oppressive religious thing that was keeping them from enjoying life. I was miserable. I don't know what I had to tell about enjoying life. But I'm like, listen, you know, this is just the thing about sin. It's just to get you to, like, do whatever they want you to do for whatever. They're trying to control you. You know, the truth is, if God wanted to control you, he'd make you a tree. And you'd just stand there and do whatever. That's actually not true. So I remember the more that I dove into this, whatever somebody told me was a sin, I would just dive in because they're not going to control me. Like, whatever that is, let's do that. And the truth is, what it is, it's just death. God's life itself, like all life comes from him. And the word actually means to miss that mark of life. It's like missing that mark. Like, we're hitting over here and there's death over here. And so he's not a slave driver. He doesn't force anyone. He's not coercive like that. He romances you and gives you freedom to see it and choose for yourself, because true love honors your freedom, and you have it. And so he's like giving you this whole huge, well, anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself, but so I, at that time, as I dive into that, I just feel more and more dead inside, deader and deader and deader and deader and deader and deader, until I just want my outside to match my inside, and I don't want to wake up anymore, and I plan to commit suicide. And on that day I planned to commit suicide, I had a crazy experience. I wrote about it in the book, but I ended up encountering God. And I thought all Christians had this. Later on, I was very confused how Christians acted, because I didn't realize this was a unique experience. I actually had something like a near-death experience. where I saw my life and I saw that I saw a creator. I saw God. And I was terrified. I mean, can you imagine? I didn't believe in this, and here I am. I was terrified. It was horrible. It was horrifying. I would rather have him send me whatever hell was than stand in front of that, because when somebody does something, he's like perfect, holy, good, love, perfect, that can make a universe that exists for billions of years, and here we are. Like, he's perfect, holy God, loving everything good and anything is always him, all the time. Everything you love and burn, like beyond, it's him and everything. And I saw it. And if somebody does something good for you and you know you don't deserve it, you're like, no, it's okay, that's okay, that's okay. No. It's like that times a million. It tortures you. Like, God is love. And I saw, I was straight up hatred. I had so much hatred in me. And to stand there was so, it wasn't right. And I'm a person of justice. So I was like, justice is that I would not be in front of you. And at the same time, he never looked away. I know people say that he looks away. He doesn't look away. We look away. We want to hide. That's how it was from the beginning. We want to hide. He's looking for us. We're like, where are you at? He's like, and that was so, everything was there, right? Everything I ever felt, thought, said, done, and everything anybody did, it was just like my life right there all at once. There's eternity. There's no time. It's like eternity. And it was scary. And he was like looking at me with such love, and I was like, I can't stand here. It's too much. I'm so hateful. And then I woke up out of that. I remember thinking, why did I survive that? I should be dead. I didn't even want to live here. And here I am. Why did you save my life? And I still don't know the answer to that. And I know people that had that same death wish and didn't survive. And I don't know why, except that I'm here to tell you that there's more to the story than just what we see on the surface. There's purpose in every bit of pain that we go through. There's purpose in every single thing that we walk through. There's more to the story. There's more than just our what we see. And I remember waking up and going, wow, like, I'm not an accident. This life isn't an accident. It's actually intentional. And every single person, I remember going to the school that day, looking around all the people I hated the day before, and I looked at them and I was like, oh my, like, I was walking to school actually, and I was like, I love art, and here's these trees and these birds, and I love pictures of trees and birds, and here, like, living trees that, like, live and, like, make more trees and birds that, like, sing, and, like God is the artist of all artists, right? He's, like, makes living things that are beautiful, that have smells and music, and like, what's the point of that? You know, what's the point of having taste buds? Like, we feed our dog like the same thing every day. Like, what? Like, he loves you. He wants like to show you he loves you. He's like multifaceted, beautiful colors. And anyway, I'll keep talking. But when I remember, I was looking at that on the way to school, and I sat down in the cafeteria, looking at all the people I hated the day before, and realizing, oh my God, these people are his masterpieces. Like, this is his crowning work. This is his art. You're his art. Each one of you, a DNA like no one's ever had, ever, or ever will have. Each one of you unique in a way that only you can be the way that you are, and you say something about the artist, about who God is. And you're beautiful. You're beautiful. Like, I just remember being fascinated with everybody after that. I wanted to know, because I like artists, you know, I want to like learn all the lyrics, I don't want to learn all the songs, and I want to learn about the artist through the art and all that, and here we are looking at each other and not realizing what we're doing. Anyway, sorry, that was long. So, I just wanted to tell you, this song, actually, this is our last song, and I want to tell you that tonight. It is an honor to be with you. That's not a greeting card that you get at Hallmark or whatever. That's the truth. It's an honor to be with you tonight. And I'm thankful that we all get to be in this moment together. We're in a present, eternal moment right now, in the moment. And I'm thankful. And I'm just thankful. So this song's called All Around Me. I feel you on your feet.
secret prayers. The music makes me sway. The angels sing inside. The